Welcome, fellow Kerbonauts, to Kerbrol Space Program. My name is Rice. I am a KSP minimalist, and this is the Minimalist Space Program. Now, what we have here is a little foresight into what our future minimalist Moonbase will probably be like. Keep in mind, a lot of this is in the prototype phase, and chances are some of what you see here probably won't end up on the Moon. Still, it's neat to see some of the options that we have to play around with. Most notably is this little guy here. This is going to be the first thing we're going to put on the Moon, and this guy is our base assembler. He can also be used as a rover, and you notice those two docking ports on him, as well as those two fuel tanks, so he serves a dual purpose. He is going to pick up all the modules that we land on the Moon, and he's going to take those modules and assemble them together. And with those amazing fuel tanks, it's also going to serve as our base refueler. Now, what we have here next is a living module of sorts. Fairly standard, enough to carry two Kerbals. And you notice the landing legs in addition to the landing gears on that living module. All the modules that we bring to the Moon will have the ability to be moved about, train style. And at the head of this wonderful Moon train will be our base assembler. Now, the base assembler doesn't carry any battery power on it. All of it is supplied by those radial thermal generators, which means that the vehicle itself is only capable of short bursts. But still, you'll find that's more than necessary for us to build ourselves a Moon base. Now, let's move our assembler forward and just edge him right into that living module there. And you'll see that we've got pretty good docking capabilities, especially on the ground. And now that we have successfully docked, we're going to move our module right out just beside the launch pad area. Now, the living module is going to be the one that's going to probably supply most of the power for our base, as you notice the two solar panels up there. Now, keep in mind, we're steering away from too much pizzazz. We don't want too many parts in our Moon base. And ultimately, the modules that we do decide to use, each one will have less than 30 parts. So the average part load actually is usually somewhere around 22 to 24 parts. And in some cases, some of our module pieces will only have somewhere around 13 and 14 parts. So that shouldn't push our computer too hard. And believe it or not, once we assemble the base together completely, most likely we anticipate a part load of about maybe 60 parts for the entire Moon base, all modules combined. Okay, and here we are. We're checking the lights, making sure it's all good to go, and perfect. Now, what we have here next is our utilities slash habitat module. This was my very first attempt putting together a habitat module that did not involve one of those Kerbal living cans that we so like to put up in space when we build our space stations. Basically, the same module that you see in that living module that we put out there originally. It's got four cockpits to it, and then one additional little cockpit module placed at the top with a neat little light tower. Now, chances are I probably won't be taking this one up to the Moon. As neat as it is, and I am rather proud that I put together a habitat module composed only of 1 meter parts, and let me tell you, I love 1 meter parts, mainly because of their simplicity, how light they are, and generally the spacecraft that I tend to build with happen to be pretty maneuverable. And tend to be pretty utilitarian in design, believe it or not. However, this one is probably going to be the exception of the list. Still, I decided to drag this one out here just to showcase it and show my amazing minimalistic engineering prowess here. Notice it's just the two radial thermal generators instead of the solar panels this time. So we're going to steer this guy off the pad, and we are going to dock it with the living module, which is waiting so patiently off the launch pad there for us. Things are starting to get a little bit heavy. I think this module is a little bit heavier than the living module out there. And so at this point, we start to have that little bit of danger where, oh, as you can see, looks like we popped one of the tires to our assembler module. And so what we're going to have to do, it looks like, is we're going to... I suppose we're going to have to reload this again. And so we dock this to the living module. This one is a little bit tougher to do. Anything I notice is that this specific module tends to give me a little bit of guff when I try to attach it to the rest of the MUN base. However, it still has the ability to fit if we manage to nudge it properly. You see me zooming out there, and we're going to just slowly but steadily just bump it in, making sure it's all good. Now, when we got it aligned, we drop our landing gears and we lift the vehicle up, and voila, we've got a successful dock. Okay, now we've got three modules docked together. One living slash power module, one habitat module composed of 1 meter parts, and one assembler slash rover slash refueling module. Now next up to bat is the mini lander itself. Now this is going to be the lander that's going to take Kerbals back and forth between the MUN base and between the stations that are orbiting the MUN. Now, this little module here possesses a capability for us to refuel and another neat capability of docking it to the rest of the base. As a minimalist MUN-based construction engineer slash builder designer-ist, yeah, we'll go with that. I love building items that eventually become one single module. Now, I do sometimes tend to build bases that do have modules spread out from one another, and that's perfectly fine. But when you look at it from the map view, it looks like a mess of icons just strewn about the surface of the MUN. And I like to clean that up a little bit by having everything clumped together into one single module. And it makes things a little easier, especially for our Kerbals, who don't have to go outside in the vacuum to go between modules. Oops! And, well, oh boy. Looks like our amazing lander scratched against the ground and the booster kind of exploded. Well, that's an issue that we're going to have to fix in a later model. Now, question, how are we going to get all of these modules onto the surface of the MUN? Well, ladies and gentlemen, I give you probably my most favorite craft of them all, the Lifter. Carrying 36 parts and weighing in at 35.71 tons, this is one of the most complex and part-heavy vehicles we'll be sending up there. Now, what is a lifter? Well, a lifter is essentially a sky crane vehicle that carries things from space or from orbit of a planet and brings them down to the surface of the planet. Generally, they're designed to carry medium to heavy loads. Now, the neat thing, and what I absolutely love about lifters, is it gives your bases some mobile capability. Land your base on the equator of Duna and change your mind? Well, no problem. We'll simply lift each individual module, bring them back into orbit, and drop them off in the poles if you so choose, or maybe into that amazing looking canyon that you saw from orbit. Lifters allow versatility, and I absolutely love versatility, and versatility is the essence of minimalism. Now, the unfortunate characteristic of lifters is they tend to be a little bit part-heavy sometimes. As you can see, the part load on this vehicle is 36, and generally when any vehicle exceeds 30 parts, I tend to cringe a little bit, because as a minimalist, I tend to shoot for vehicles that fall within the 20-part range, so 36 is pushing it. However, because of the wide capabilities of this vehicle, and just the sheer number of uses you can use with this guy, I can forgive the part load on this vehicle. And let's face it, we've all seen space vehicles from other channels and from other Kerbal Space Program videos with vehicles that exceed way beyond the 36-part load limit. And additionally, well, this helps us in the long run. How, you might ask? Well, it lowers the part count load for our bases themselves. Individual base modules don't have to have thrusters or boosters or RCS tanks because they're already provided with this lifter. The modules don't have to land themselves because the lifter will do that for you. Now, what time is it? It's pinpoint landing time. Rather than leaving this vehicle parked in orbit, we are going to test the accuracy of its landing ability. And where we're going to go is the future home of our moon base, and that'll be on the flag just to the east of us. Now, I've got to tell you, my most favorite thing to do in this game, other than docking, is pinpoint landing. Unfortunately, is probably one of the most challenging things to learn in this game. And you can take it either one of two routes. You can either plot your trajectory to a landing zone using the maneuver nodes, or you can do this manually yourself without maneuver nodes. And for me, I usually prefer to do it without maneuver nodes, mainly because landing in many ways is like docking, except with a time limit. And docking, you can take all the time in the world. You can stop your vehicle, get a judge of where you are, and then plot your maneuver mode. For landing, however, you are constantly losing altitude. And during those moments when you need to plot where you're going to land, those precious few seconds that you have can't be spent plotting your maneuver nodes. And so I plan my maneuver very carefully by remembering the four different degrees whereby you can where you can set the area you're going to land. So, for example, if you turn your ship 90 degrees, you are going to change your point of landing towards the east. If you turn 270 degrees, you're going to move your landing point to the west. If you turn your craft 180 degrees, you're going to turn your landing point to the south. And if you turn to 0 degrees, well, you're going to turn your landing point to the north. If you remember those four points, those 4 degrees on your nav ball, then you really don't need a maneuver node. For instance, take this situation here. Right now, I'm trying to move my point of landing towards the flag. Unfortunately, my point of landing is to the east of the flag, so I need to turn it west. In order to turn it west, I'm going to change my bearing, my heading, to 270 degrees. As you can see, I'm thrusting 270 degrees, and I ended up just to the north of the flag, so I need to turn it south. In order to do that, I need to turn my heading to 180 degrees. There we go. And then we start thrusting to lower my point of landing. Now, the point where you want to land is generally right at the base of the staff of that flag icon. There we are. Okay. And we've almost got it, so we're going to turn it a little bit more to the west by changing my heading a little bit there. Oops, a little bit overcompensated. Okay, there we are to 270 degrees, and then we start thrusting again. Now be mindful, especially if you're at a higher altitude, and that the planet is rotating underneath your craft. And because the Mun is rotating from west to east, and the flag is moving towards the east, well, you'll want to move your landing point just slightly to the east to compensate for that. So here we are, time warping just a little bit while we drop down. Okay, now you notice that I selected the target. Now this is really important, and I think this was a really awesome feature that was added to the game, where you can select targets that are on the surface of the Mun, because now the target appears on your nav ball. Now, in an ideal situation, what you want to focus on is moving your green retrograde marker over the pink target marker. This is really important. Now, when you start to come close, you want to make sure that you push that retrograde marker just slightly off of that pink target marker, because what'll happen is that retrograde marker, if it's overlaying on top of the target marker, that means you're going to be landing right on top of the vehicle. And I'm pretty sure unless you have a landing pad on top of your vehicle, you don't want to end up crushing it. So, in essence, you'll want to put your green retrograde marker just over the pink retrograde marker until the last moment. Now, here we go. We are thrusting downwards. Keep in mind that at about this point, there's nothing you can do with the pink retrograde marker, but there is a whole lot you can do with the green retrograde marker. You can move it around by simply moving your vehicle and push the marker around wherever you need it to go. Ultimately, though, you want to put the green retrograde marker towards the center of your nav ball. And ultimately, that green retrograde marker is going to naturally move to the center of that nav ball. So you want to be careful of that, especially if the pink target marker is not in the center of your nav ball. In a really ideal situation, that pink target marker would be at the top of your nav ball, along with the retrograde marker at the top of your nav ball as well. But 99% of the time, that's not going to happen. Most of the time, you can get that pink retrograde marker pretty close to the center of the nav ball, but that takes a whole lot of skill. Now, in my experience doing pinpoint landings, I've generally managed to maintain some pretty good consistency in that most of the time I can land within about 20 meters of a given target using these techniques. Oh, and look at that. We got the pink retrograde marker in the center of the nav ball. Absolutely wonderful. Okay, so let's push that green retrograde marker right over the pink target marker as close as we can get it because we're coming up on the target real quick now. Here we go, and we want to slow ourselves down at the same time. Also, additionally, and this is what makes it more challenging too, is you want to cut that lateral velocity. You don't want to be moving slantwise of the target and having to accidentally topple over. Okay, so we've got our shadow, and we've got our light source visible now, so we're getting really close. So at this point, you can pretty much eyeball your landing. As for me, I'm still looking at the nav ball, and I'm still pushing that retrograde marker over the pink target. Really close. Here we go. Looks like the flag is going to be right underneath my landing leg, which is close enough. And there we are. We are landing at about 16 meters from the flag. Absolutely perfect. And there we go. That's pretty much pinpoint landing 101 there. And it takes a little bit of practice to do. If you've never done pinpoint landing before, you're going to be doing it quite a number of times before you get it right. But once you nail it down, you'll feel like you're king of the world. I'll tell you, I feel like I'm king of the world every time I complete a pinpoint landing, especially with something like this. All right, now that we've got our lifter on the MUN, it is now ready to accept the modules necessary for the construction of our minimalist moon base. Once again, my name is Rice. This episode is minimalist approved. And against the backdrop of that amazing eclipse, we will see you all next time.